question for you. Can you guess what's behind my back right now? Who said that? Raise your hand boldly. Is that even what's behind my back? Bread. Is that because you can see behind my back? Is that why you guessed that? That's good. That's good. What are some things we can make with this kind of bread? What do we got here? Yeah. Toast. We can make toast with some peanut butter on it, maybe? That sounds pretty tasty. What about anybody? Maybe a PBJ? So make the toast with some peanut butter, then add jelly on top. A ham sandwich, I like those too. What else can you make with this? We can make a face by using other food with the bread. So this is like the head, and then we put meat on it to make the eyes, huh? Okay, I like that idea. Like pepperonis? Put some olives maybe on top of the pepperonis for the eyeballs? What do you think, Libby? What can we make with this? Make a different kind of sandwich with it. You know what I like to make with bread? Maybe you guys do too, but French toast. You guys like French toast? Yeah, right? With some eggs and cinnamon on there and some vanilla. With sugar and butter. And then just top it off with some syrup, right? Right? Oh, you don't like syrup on these? You don't like syrup either? No. You don't like syrup either? That's okay. How about Pastor Lee eat all the syrup? Kenna likes syrup? Okay. Well, Kenna and I will eat all the syrup then. Mm-hmm. Is that okay? You'll have syrup on your pancakes, maybe? No, you won't have syrup on your pancakes. You just eat them plain. That's okay. Some people eat their bread and their pancakes plain. You put chocolate chip on yours. Do you? Well, I have another question for you. What happens if we don't eat all this bread over time? It'll rot. It'll get old. It gets squishy. Maybe it has like some green spots on it and some fungus. It'll taste really bad. It'll get sick. Okay. So if we don't eat it all right away, it spoils. But what happens if we eat it all right away and it doesn't spoil? Then it's all gone, right? Then what are we gonna eat? We'll have to go to the store and get more bread. But then that bread's gonna run out too. And then you'll eat it, and then you'll run out of more bread. There's not enough bread. Then you'll have to get more bread and more bread and more bread, right? What's the easier solution, Alex?
You can run out of wheat and just make your own bread.
Get wheat and make my own bread. I'm going to let your mom make bread because I can't make bread. It is freshly made. What's up, buddy? If I didn't have a job and I ran out of money, I would die. That is very true. I could, or I could get another job, but you know, there's not a lot of jobs out there for me right now. But except for this one, that's right. That's right. But in our gospel lesson this morning, we heard about how Jesus is the bread of life that doesn't spoil. His bread never runs out, right, Evan? It never runs out. It always feeds us and always satisfies us. Right, Libby? Right. Jesus is the bread of life that always tastes good and is always there for us. Can we thank him for that? Why don't we do that? Let's bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for sending Jesus, your son, to be the bread of life that is always there for us. He provides for our need and gives us the nourishment that we need to be strong in you. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, guys. Go ahead and go back to mom and dad or grandma and grandpa. Thanks for coming up. All right, friends. We'll sing the second two verses of our hymn. salvation known. He has remembered his love and his faithfulness to his people. Amen. My friends, not long after Stacy and I moved to Clovis, California, after we were married, we took my grandmother out because we wanted to introduce her to Starbucks coffee. Now, she had been there before. She had had all those foo-foo drinks and those milkshake type of beverages that they had served her, but this time we were going to introduce her to not only a ton of sugar, but also a lot of espresso. And so we introduced her to a caramel macchiato, and she's been drinking them ever since. However, after we sat there with her for 2 hours, talking, drinking coffee, laughing, catching up after my years in the service, Stacy and I decided that we were going to go home. And so we got up, walked out the door, and as soon as the three of us got outside, we saw something amazing take place. There was a homeless man outside asking for money. Now that's not amazing. We see homeless people all the time, all over the place in California. The homeless man walked up to me and asked me for money. And I said, "I don't have any cash, I'm sorry." Which is true, but that wasn't the amazing thing either. After we were done talking with him, another man walks up. He was wearing a suit. And the homeless man gets tired of us and he goes over to the man wearing the suit and he asks him for money as well. And the man in the suit asks him his name and asks his story to find out a little bit more about him. And then after the man in the suit finds out this guy's story, he extends his hand to go and shake it, and he offers him a job. Now, I thought that was pretty cool. However, the amazing thing wasn't the job opportunity that was just presented to this homeless man. The amazing thing was his response. You see, the homeless guy turned him down. In fact, what he told him was, "No thanks, that's not what I'm really looking for, but I'll take some money if you got that." Isn't that often how people treat Jesus? Jesus comes and he finds people in their tired, worn, dirty, exhausted state. He extends his hand. He introduces himself. He reveals how he meets every single need in our lives in a variety of ways. And what's the response he gets? "No thanks, that's not really what I'm looking for, but I'll take what you have to give me." We often treat Jesus like a grab-and-go, like a dollar treat, someone there just to provide a little bit of something at a particular moment in time. Yet Jesus came down to earth to be a loaf that satisfies our lives. The background of the text that is before us contains something pretty amazing. It contains a miracle. Jesus had just fed 5,000 people with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. And that's not including the women and the children. And after he does this and the people are fed, he leaves. He goes to this mountaintop and the disciples head off to the Sea of Galilee. They get in a boat and they set sail out on the water. But then the waters start to become rough. They get scared. Jesus appears to them walking on the water, and they become even more terrified until he says, "It's all right, it's just me." And then they calm down, he gets in the boat, and all of them head over to Capernaum. The next day, that's what's in the text before us now. The next day, the crowds, the multitudes who he had just fed, finally find him. And what did they say? They say, "When did you get here?" But the funny thing about Jesus is he's awesome. He doesn't answer how you think he's going to answer. He doesn't answer their question. Instead, he points to their motive. You see, the reason why Jesus left to go to that mountaintop wasn't because he didn't care for the people anymore. It wasn't because he didn't love them, or because he didn't want to provide for them, or because he didn't want to give them what the Father sent him to. The reason he left was because they wanted to force him to become the king they wanted him to be. In other words, they weren't looking for who he said he was and what he came to do. They were acting just like that homeless man outside of Starbucks. They didn't want what was being offered. They wanted what they desired. And their question is, when? We often address our comments to God similarly, don't we? When? When are you going to give me a little breather between those endless bills that just keep racking up? When are you going to cause this concern from living daily, day to day, check to check, moment to moment? When are you going to cause that type of tension to just filter away? When are you going to cause that anxiety that causes depression and debilitation of the uncertainty of tomorrow to just float away? Now those, I think it's safe to say that all of us at some point have had those concerns. In fact, some of you might have those concerns right now. And those are valid concerns. Because oftentimes we focus on the here and the now, and we can't see past those. A few months after Stacy and I were married, we had a rough go of it for a while. Stacy flew out from Saginaw, Michigan to Norfolk, Virginia, where I picked her up from the airport. We drove from Virginia to Wausau, Wisconsin. We packed up her entire apartment, including that giant baby grand piano that now sits in our music room, which was awesome. And then we moved from Wausau, Wisconsin to Clovis, California, because I was going to start school to be a pastor out there. We were living off of the wedding money that we had received, and that was slowly dissipating. My VA benefits weren't going to kick in until after school started in September, and Stacy hadn't found work yet. We didn't know how we were going to make it. In fact, at one point, things got so bad for us, we only had $100 in the bank account, and we had to write a check for $700 for our rent that week. The prospect of losing someone is extremely tough, but the prospect of losing your home is probably one of the hardest things a person can deal with. We found ourselves on our knees quite a bit, speaking with God, usually with words that started like, when and how long. A few days before our rent check was due, we were running out of food, and we needed something, even if it was ramen noodles or some bread to make some PB&Js. And so we went to the bank and we checked our bank account to see if there was anything in there we could possibly pull out just to eat. And to our amazement, there was money in the account. It wasn't a lot, but it was enough to pay our rent. It was enough to buy food. We had no idea how it got there, but it was more than enough to take care of us. And a few weeks later, Stacy received a phone call to teach preschool. Now, when those things happen, our natural inclination is to go to those wondrous things and just go, yes, focus on those instead of how they got there. I'm sure all of us have run into various situations like that over time. And when those moments happen, we're quick to say, this is what I want, this is what I need, and this is when I need it. And the funny thing that I've learned in my time of life and my time of faith is that God does not answer my prayers when I want them. Sometimes it's 5 minutes later. Sometimes it's 5 days later. Sometimes it's in the last possible second before the minute's going to hit the next moment. And when that next moment happens, all heck is going to break loose and my world is going to end. But right there, that last possible second, that's when God answers. But we're often focused on that second, that thing we need, instead of where it comes from. The crowd may have been asking when, but what they were really asking was why. You see, they weren't seeking the giver, they were seeking the gift. They were seeking provisions that spoil and fade and go away. They were seeking Jesus merely to get them from one momentary disaster to the next. And don't we often do the same? When does our life in His Word increase? When does our prayer life drastically get more frequent? Isn't it when times are tough? It can be as simple as, God, please give me the strength to get through this day of work because these people are driving me crazy. And other times, it could be something as serious as a poor diagnosis, either on a car or our bodies. And we're like, please, just give me some answers. Give me a cure. Yet the thing is Jesus didn't come down from heaven to serve as a loaf of bread for a meal. He didn't come to serve as a loaf of bread for a day or for a moment. He came to serve as a loaf of bread that satisfies our lives. A bread that lasts forever. He points our thoughts to the endless blessings that come just from simply knowing who He is. How He reveals Himself to us. He said, I am the bread of life that didn't come to do my will, but the one who sent me. Jesus is what provides nourishment. He's the one that provides life. He's using a figure of speech here because, see, the bread that I just showed the little kids, He wasn't necessarily talking about the stuff that they eat. He was using bread to tell them, this is your life. This is what you crave after. And you work. And this bread will either spoil or run out. But I offer you bread that doesn't. I offer you bread that lasts. I offer you life that lasts. Give us this bread, right? And He said, I am the bread. Friends, when we focus our attention on that bread of life who has given us life, all other blessings become really clear and apparent in our lives. You think that was the alarm clock that woke you up this morning to that really annoying No. That was God's call to you to say, breathe. live. Wait. You think it's by our own strength that we earn a living, that money miraculously just appears in an account? No, he provides us the ability to work with the gift of work, that he provides our wages through that work so that we can put food in the fridge, food on the table, and food in our stomachs, and food in our souls that he distributes here. Jesus gives us the strength not to live from one disastrous moment to the next, but to see us through the events of every moment of life into the joyful bliss of tomorrow, and the next tomorrow, and the next tomorrow until eternity. That's the life and prosperity that never ends, that Jesus came to give us, in which we have. But it seemed too good to be true. It seemed too easy. There had to be something that had to come that made it possible for this to happen. It had to come at a cost. That's what the crowds thought. What do I have to do to get this thing? What do I have to pay to get this food that lasts? Doesn't that sound like the content of our prayers? Dear God, what do you want from me? What do I need to fix so that this stuff doesn't happen anymore? What do I need to remedy so that I don't need to be dependent on anyone else in this life? And often what we find out is that we can't do anything. What I mean by that is that even if we wanted to do something, we can't. And even if we attempted to do something, we screw it up further. When Stacy and I lived in Minnesota while I was going to school at Martin Luther College, we lived in this little town that you've probably heard of. It's called Sleepy Eye, right? Little house on the prairie, Sleepy Eye. And we rented our house from this old, proud German man named Leroy and his wife, Alice May. They were a sweet couple. They were. And there was a water heater, a 50-gallon water heater, that we enjoyed until it died. And we asked for a replacement. And he said, oh, it's probably just the heating coil. And he was right. It was the heating coil. They stopped working. And I said, well, are you going to have someone come and repair that? Nope. I'll come over and take care of it myself. And so he comes over to take care of it with his wrench. And the washers and the nuts are rusted over, and he can't get them loose. And so I'm like, so are you gonna call somebody now to fix it? And he says, no, you got a hammer? And he grabs a hammer, and he grabs a chisel, and he tries to loosen that thing, and what he ends up doing is splitting it just like that. Finally, that wonderful, proud German man, Leroy, says, all right, I'll call somebody. We'll get them to get those bolts off and those nuts off, and we'll pull the heating coils out. And the guy comes over to repair this thing, and he says, sorry, it's too busted. I can't do anything with it now. Now you have to repair the entire unit. You have to replace it. And so that's what he did. Leroy replaced our 50-gallon water heater with a 40-gallon water heater that was the cheapest you could possibly buy. His solution to fix it cost more than he intended. Because it wasn't just 10 gallons less. The pipes from the wall where the water came out were right here, and the pipes that needed to be connected to it was right here. And so in order to connect those pipes, he did something that you should not do anymore. He used copper insulated piping, which leaked water and ran down into the exposed wiring system that he forgot to take care of. Pride is the opposite of humility. It's the opposite of trust. What do we have to do to obtain this? bread that lasts. Like the crowds, we often think that there's some list of actions that we can do that can possibly fix our situations in life. And if that were not bad enough, we actually think that we can carry them out to completion. What is the work that needs to be done to get this bread that lasts? And Jesus tells them, this is the work of God, that you believe. Depending on God for help is a sign of humility and trust. That's what Jesus said was needed, trust. This trust wasn't something that was done on them because they could not achieve that level of trust. The overwhelming opposition would lead them to the opposite. This work of trust is what God does in us. Trust in the life that He came to win for us. That trust is what sustains us through the promises that Jesus has for you and me. A life full and saturated in Him with all blessing and meaning and purpose. How can we know for sure? That's what they say. We want a miracle. We want to see something. As if they just forgot that He fed them with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. And that they also forgot that even before they came to Him, the reason why they came was because Jesus had been healing the sick and the decaying and the injured in their area. We want a miracle. And if we're really honest with ourselves, friends, that's our attitude also. We want something that we can see, something that we can taste, something that we can touch, something that we can hold. Can there be any greater proof than the flesh that Jesus gave for the life of the world, for your life and for mine? We go to Him seeking a miracle, and He points us to those nail-pierced hands of His that provided peace between us and the God we grumble against. We cry after a sign, and He points us to those thorn-pierced holes in His head that bore the weight of our worries in this life. We go to Him and say, we want to see a wonder. We want to taste it. And He puts His body in our mouth to give us strength to live in a world of uncertainty. We clamor for something that we can touch. And He clasps our hands to that gaping wound in His side that blood and water gushed out from to wash away the death we deserve, to give us the life that He earned. We want something that we can hold. And He gives us His word that our heart clasps onto, of the certain hope of the blessings to come because of what He's already given. We want wonders. We want miracles. We want signs. And He's already given them. That's His seal of approval. Jesus came down as the living bread that saturates and satisfies our lives. He gave us a life by giving up His for ours. Do you want further evidence? Scroll through the Rolodex of your minds. Scroll through the photo albums in your homes. Because it's God, the living bread, that got you from one smiling moment to the next. to give you a lifetime of joy. A lifetime that doesn't end here, but extends on into eternity. There's nothing we must do yesterday, today, or tomorrow to obtain that provision. We simply believe it. We simply eat it. And we find our satisfaction through it. So what are you waiting for? Pick up a slice and enjoy the feast. Amen. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, guards your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.